Well, welcome to the shop. We have a little bit to go over, a little bit of a lesson learned that I have to share with you guys. So let's get started. All right, before we get into today's video, I have to give a huge shout out to a good friend of mine, Jeff Poole. You can follow him on Instagram. Absolutely phenomenal photographer. And a while back during this whole COVID crisis, he had taken some photos of last year's Flight Fest, and he made some phenomenal prints for me. Jeff, you are so nice to me. And these memories in my shop are just absolutely phenomenal. I cannot thank you enough. Guys, go check out Jeff's work. Do me a favor. It took me a while to, you know, get to a craft store and get proper frames for these. I'm so glad that they can remind me every single day of good friends and good memories that I have in this hobby. Let's get back into what we're gonna learn today. All right, so for those of you who have been really long followers of the channel, you'll remember a video from back in 2014 or 2015, somewhere in that line, I tried to fly this airplane. All right, it's a very short clip. It's worth your while to just take a break, pause me right now, and have a look at it because it's kind of funny. Anyway, so long story short, this airplane, this is the FFVS J-22. It's a Swedish fighter that was developed during World War II. And it's a very interesting history, and I love this subject. It's my favorite fighter, and I built this all out of dollar store foam. This is dollar store foam that has been had the paper taken off of it, and it's been shaped. I've got a airfoiled wing complete with washout, and I mean all of this is all foam. The horizontal stabs and vertical stab have been hot wire cut. So anyway, what I need to show you now is another clip.
Ready? Yeah, go ahead.
So as you saw in that clip, the results were not much different. Let's go over what happened here. This is a World War II era style fighter, but it has a very short nose couple. With that short nose coupling, I figured that the center of gravity range was very, very, very small. And to be fair, it is. However, if you look right here, probably can't see it from your distance, but there are black dots right here. That's my center of gravity. All right. So on that last clip that you saw, the center of gravity was actually a quarter of an inch ahead of that mark. As you can see, that is a far, far distance away from the trailing edge. This is well within the 25% mean aerodynamic chord of the wing. All right, so it's not tail heavy. It's not tail heavy. One of my club members, actually my club president, was looking at the model after the crash with the wing still attached, and he said, "You know, your wing incidence looks really, really big." And I said, well, I know that there were some incidents built into the plans. And I did build this from plans. Marcus Thorn, I think that's how you pronounce it. I'm sorry if it's wrong. His plans did call for 2 degrees of incidence of the main wing and 0 degrees incidence of the tail. Now, that is all relative to the airplane datum. So that's essentially the thrust line. Take a point for where the propeller is, and you draw it straight through the middle of the airplane, through the fuselage. So what I did was, with the airplane assembled, without the nose, obviously, I set it up on the table here and I started measuring my incidences. So I made sure that the datum line was level, and I know that that's level because of the distances between where I had cut the hatch. So the hatch sits like this. So this hatch line was actually level with the datum line. So all I had to do was get a little bubble level that I have and elevate the airplane like this until the datum was level. From there, I got this little thing out. This little thing I have had under my bench for years. This is a Hanger 9 Angle Pro digital inclinometer. And if that's a mouthful, I don't know what is or isn't, that says a lot. So what you do is you simply turn it on, and as you tilt it, it tells you positive or negative degrees. So with that, I got this out and I put it on the main wings at the root, and I adjusted it to tighten it right up against the tail edge and the leading edge. And you know, I'll be darned if the main wing was wrong. So again, the main wing was supposed to be 2 degrees, right? The main wing was 4.2 degrees. Okay, well that's a lot, but it didn't seem like crazy, because I've heard of airplanes using a lot of incidents in the main wing. What's going on with the tail? So I took the tail, I used my paint stick method of making sure that the elevator was level. I did that on one side because they're connected together. And then I did the same thing with my inclinometer, and I set it up just like this and measured the angle. What was the angle? Well, the plans called for 0 degrees. It was -2 degrees. So essentially you have a situation where instead of having this tailplane at 0 and this main wing at just a little bit of positive incidence, you have a whole lot of positive incidence and negative incidence. So that's going to cause the angle of attack on the main wing to be exacerbated significantly. That's why it rolled so violently. So the takeoff in both instances was great. It was a good takeoff. They were good throws. The second one was a little bit better. It was more straight out. But then all of a sudden there's just this violent twisting. And the reason for that is the second I changed my elevator to get a little bit of altitude, the angle of attack on the main wing changed, and it was so dramatic that it completely stalled the entire wing because of the incidence. I can't stress this enough. There are aerodynamics at play here in these models. And this is a lesson for me that I simply built this airplane wrong. Let's go over how that could have happened. The way this airplane is constructed, and the way that I can show you, is really easy because it's kind of fallen apart. So there is a middle former that was laid out on plans, and then these formers, there are two halves, and the formers in foam were placed on one half, and then that other half, that half of the skeleton of foam, was sheeted in segments of foam skin, and that was all done with Gorilla Glue. Okay, then the problem came when I took it off of the building board. I turned it over and again set up all of those formers and then skinned that second side of the fuselage. What happened is that as I was constructing that second side, the fuselage got warped. So the strength of this model comes from everything locking together and keying in. I mean, this is a strong model, okay? And it weighs next to nothing. It is fiberglass, but it's not fiberglass with epoxy. It's just water-based polyurethane, okay? So it's not like I'm getting a whole lot of strength out of epoxy. I wanted this to be super lightweight so that I could chuck it around. It was going to be a belly lander. The fuselage just got warped. And when I went and installed my planes, I did not use the tool I had, all right? With the horizontal stabilizer, what I should have done is dry fitted it, and I would have instantly realized that something was wrong if I had checked with this. I wouldn't even need the elevators to be on. I just needed the horizontal stabilizer in place. I can check that. I would have been able to see that incidence being off so dramatically and have been able to carve the foam so that it would sit properly in the slot at the right inclination. As it is, it's all glued together, and to fix it, I'd have to completely tear apart and rebuild the whole tail end. It gets even worse when you go to the main wing section, because it's a wing saddle. The way that the wing saddle is constructed is there was a cutout here in this former that, again, it got warped as I sheeted the sides of the fuselage. So as I set the main wing in here, I just assumed that it was correct because, well, I built one half of the fuselage over the plans. It should be fine. This profile here should define where the wing is going to sit. Not so. This wing should have the trailing edge elevated at least half of a centimeter, if not a full centimeter, higher. And that would have changed how the belly pan would have fit on the bottom of the wing. So if I were to fix this, I would have to fix this. This whole model can never be flown. I would have to essentially reconstruct the entire belly plan, which is hard fiberglass with epoxy because it was going to be a belly lander. This, not so much, because I've already got my mounting plate for the wing where it bolts in, and this whole front end has been broken off multiple times now. It wasn't a power issue. I had approximately 850 watts on tap to launch this plane on this motor. I had a different motor, but the same prop, about the same amount of power, maybe a little bit less on the first attempt, but it's not a power issue. I had plenty of power to fly this model. All up, we're talking about maybe 2 pounds. The battery would weigh more than this entire airplane. It weighs next to nothing. So take it from me and take this lesson to check your build as you go. As we move into building season, it's already late August, I want you to take a moment and consider whether or not you have the right tools for your project. More than anything else, more than the proper wheels or those expensive Oleo struts or the Robart retracts or this special thing that you're going to put on your model, make sure you have the right tools to build your model in a safe way and a way that you can enjoy the end result. This model sat on my shelf for about 4 or 5 years before I was like, you know what? I've got no other models I really want to get fully involved in right now. I'll just put this back together. And the same thing happened. All because I did not check as I built. I had the tool. I just didn't use it. Learn from me, please. And I encourage you to check out my other building tips and my construction techniques. Have the most fun with your models by making sure that they're going to fly. This would have been a beautiful work of art. I've got Cali graphics for it that I'm never going to use now. So until I get motivation to try this subject again, continue to build and properly build your flying work of art.